my name is Dr. Uma Thanarajasingam. I am an assistant professor of rheumatology at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Our paper is entitled Scleroderma Induced by Pembrolizumab, a Case Series, and it is set to appear in the July 2017 issue of the Mayo Clinic Proceedings. In our paper, we present the first and largest series of two patients who developed scleroderma while on pembrolizumab therapy for their metastatic melanoma. The emergence of two cases that are similar of patients on pembrolizumab for their melanoma, we felt was warranted broad reporting to improve recognition of this condition and prompt rapid referral and treatment, with the goal being to optimize and improve patient outcomes. Pembrolizumab is an immune checkpoint inhibitor. Immune checkpoint molecules such as CTLA-4 and PD-1 typically in the normal host work to decrease T-cell responses and promote self-tolerance. It's been shown that immune checkpoint inhibition has actually led to improved overall survival in metastatic melanoma. And as a consequence, these medications have been approved for the use of advanced melanoma as well as other advanced malignancies. And their indications for approval are rapidly expanding as time goes on. By virtue of their mechanism of action, immune checkpoint inhibitors, or ICIs, do cause a lot of adverse events. And some of these adverse events are termed immune-related adverse events, which manifest as systemic or organ-specific autoimmunity. Dermatologically speaking, the most common adverse events seen with immune checkpoint inhibitors are usually pruritus, dermatitis, and vitiligo. There are rheumatologic toxicities reported with these ICIs as well, most commonly arthralgias and myalgias. We describe a series of two patients who have developed scleroderma while on pembrolizumab therapy, and this as a series has never previously been reported. Our first patient was a 66-year-old male with a BRAF mutant stage 4 metastatic melanoma. He was started on pembrolizumab therapy at 2 mg per kg every 3 weeks. After he had remarkable response to pembrolizumab with his metastatic melanoma going into remission. However, after about cycle 14 of pembrolizumab therapy, he started to develop some swollen joints. And after cycle 14, he developed a lot of weakness and fatigue. So the therapy was discontinued and he was started on high-dose prednisone therapy. However, despite the prednisone, he continued to worsen and started to complain of tightening of the skin in his arms and legs. So he was referred to dermatology, where indeed it was confirmed that he had moderate to severe thickening of the skin on his forearms, his wrists, his thighs, and his lower legs. This gave a modified Rodnan skin score of greater than 30. Skin biopsies were taken, and this showed mild lymphocytic infiltration, but very deep dermal fibrosis and sclerosis, consistent with a sclerosing skin process. Because he continued to worsen, he was eventually referred to rheumatology, where we confirmed the exam. Eventually, a diagnosis of diffuse scleroderma based on the skin biopsy and the clinical pattern as seen on exam and featured in pictures from our manuscript was made. Because of the severity of his condition, we initiated him on immunosuppressive treatment with mycophenolate mofetil as well as IVIG and tapering doses of prednisone. Within about 6 to 8 weeks, he had objective improvement in his skin findings as reported by his local oncologist. However, at week 14, he started to develop new symptoms of early satiety, more weakness, and more fatigue. and more workup was recommended to try to address the etiology of his concerns. But the patient eventually opted for hospice care and passed away soon thereafter. An autopsy was declined. Our second patient was also a male, a 79-year-old male who developed BRAF wild-type metastatic melanoma, which was stage 4 as well, and he was initiated on treatment similarly with pembrolizumab. After about 5 cycles of treatment, he started to develop swelling in his hands and as well as stiffness and skin tightening. The pembrolizumab was discontinued. He was also referred to dermatology, and he had biopsies taken, which essentially showed the same process as was seen in our first patient. He was started on prednisone and this time hydroxychloroquine therapy by his oncologist, but didn't get much better. He was referred to rheumatology, where we were able to elicit an additional history of Raynaud's phenomenon, which was rather new onset and which occurred around the same time as the skin tightening had showed up in his hands. Similarly to patient 1, his serologic evaluation was largely unremarkable other than an elevated C-reactive protein. Ultimately, this patient never went on to, never returned to pembrolizumab therapy. Currently, he's being treated for a hepatic recurrence of his melanoma. Importantly, in one of the few studies that addresses this question, it was found that patients who do develop immune-related adverse events that then require additional immunosuppression do not have a decrease in overall survival compared to the cohorts that did not develop immune-related adverse events. Overall, immune checkpoint inhibitors are revolutionary medications for advanced malignancies, and we know that their use is going to continue to grow and expand, and with that, side effects, adverse events, and immune-related adverse events are going to become more common. Prompt recognition of these conditions is important, and referral to a subspecialist such as a dermatologist or a rheumatologist is paramount to help identify the disease, characterize the disease, and ideally get patients on prompt treatment that will then improve overall morbidity and hopefully allow them to continue on with their potentially life-saving cancer therapies. Thank you so much for your attention, and we hope you enjoy our article in the Mayo Clinic Proceedings.
We hope you found this presentation from the content of Mayo Clinic Proceedings valuable. Our journal's mission is to promote the best interests of patients by advancing the knowledge and professionalism of the physician community. If you are interested in more information about us, our homepage is www.mayoclinicproceedings.org. There you will find access information for our social media content, such as additional videos on our YouTube channel or journal updates on Facebook. You can also follow us on Twitter. More information about healthcare at Mayo Clinic is available at www.mayoclinic.org. This video content is copyrighted by Mayo Foundation for Medical Education and Research.